Dr. Matthew J. Gray is an assistant professor of ancient scripture at Brigham Young University. He received an MA in archaeology and the history of antiquity from Andrews University, and a master's of studies in Jewish studies from the University of Oxford, and a PhD in archaeology and the history of ancient Judaism from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. He has participated in numerous archaeological excavations and research projects relating to the world of the Bible in Israel, Jordan, and Italy, and is currently an area supervisor with excavations at an ancient Jewish village near the Sea of Galilee. So let's welcome Brother Gray.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you being here. Thank you for foregoing at least the first half of the BYU football game to attend a lecture on the archaeology of first century Capernaum. Since both topics are currently in ruins, hopefully we'll be able to bring them tonight somehow. So we are starting a little bit late tonight, but I am told that we do have to end on time. So that means we have a little less time tonight than even I was originally planning. But since I'm originally from Chicago and I can talk exceptionally fast, hopefully we'll get through as much material as we can in the time that we have. Well, I'm very grateful to participate in this very interesting Sperry Symposium on the Chief Apostle Peter. When the organizers were first putting together the topic of this symposium, they asked if I would contribute a piece to it that discusses the archaeology of Peter's world. In particular, Peter's earlier years in Galilee generally, but specifically in his hometown of Capernaum. So I want to frame this conversation with some larger scholarship that's been going on for the last several decades. As some of you probably know, for the last probably 100 years, biblical scholars have been doing what's called the quest for the historical Jesus, trying to understand who was Jesus as a historical figure. Is it possible that we can cut through 2,000 years of legend and tradition and theological accumulation to really understand who Jesus is? And that quest for the historical Jesus in the last century has produced some very interesting results. As it turns out, in the last few decades, really only in the last 10 to 20 years, a similar search by scholars have been conducted on the historical Peter. Who was Peter as a historical individual? Asking the same question, if we can cut through 2,000 years worth of theological, traditional, and legendary accumulations around this figure Peter, what can we know about him? How did this Galilean fisherman become the chief rock on which the early Christian church was built? Well, as scholars are asking these questions, here are some of the issues that they're interested in. For example, in trying to understand Peter as a first century historical figure, what can we say or know about his social and economic status? Was Peter a wealthy fisherman who left his fishing business, giving him the luxury to follow Jesus because of the wealth that he accumulated as a fisherman? Or was he a poor fisherman in Galilee who left to follow Jesus at great personal cost to him and his family? What about the extent of his literacy? Was Peter literate? Could he read and write? And more importantly, could he read and write Greek? The two letters in the New Testament that are attributed to him, 1st and 2nd Peter, are both written in very polished and sophisticated Greek. Could this Galilean fisherman have done so? Did he have the intellectual sophistication to produce these letters, or would he maybe have to rely on more educated scribes to produce these letters? Well, what about his cultural proclivities? We all know that Peter is one of the most important figures in the New Testament for bringing the message of Jesus, the gospel, to the Gentiles. Did that come naturally to Peter? Was he naturally inclined to bring the gospel to the Gentiles? Or did he have to overcome some natural cultural barriers to follow that vision and bring the message of Jesus to a non-Jewish audience? Well, these are some of the questions that scholars searching for the historical Peter have been asking. And as you can imagine with scholarship, two scholars, three opinions. Right? As a result, there are two very different models that are turning out in some of the scholarship on the historical Peter. For example, I think the most traditional way to understand Peter is the option where Peter is a poor fisherman. probably mostly illiterate, speaking Aramaic perhaps, but probably not knowing enough Greek to write the letters attributed to him. Probably conservatively Jewish, as opposed to having a natural inclination to teach Gentiles. That is the traditional model that is still upheld by some scholarship. On the other hand, some scholarship in the last 10 to 15 years has suggested maybe not. Maybe Peter actually was more wealthy, more successful, kind of a multicultural businessman who was bilingual, who could speak Aramaic as fluently as he could speak Greek, and had the sophistication to write the letters attributed to him, and who naturally reached out to Gentiles because of his kind of Hellenistic background. Well, obviously these two different models are at odds with one another. What I want to try to do tonight is ask the question, what can archaeology tell us about this discussion? Because as it turns out, in most of the studies that have been done searching for the historical Peter, very few scholars have tried to incorporate the archaeology of first century Galilee into this discussion. And as an archaeologist, I'm firmly convinced that study of the material culture of Peter's world can actually tell us a lot about Peter the man. Frankly, we don't have any direct evidence for Peter archaeologically. We don't have an "I, Peter, was here" inscription or anything like that. But what archaeology can do is help us to understand the larger world in which Peter was raised. And presumably, that larger world had an impact on him and can tell us something about Peter himself as a historical figure. Now, the Galilee, or the archaeology in this case, can apply in two different ways. Number one, it can apply regionally. What can simply the archaeology of Galilee as a whole tell us about Peter or about people like Peter? And more specifically, what can the archaeology of Capernaum tell us about Peter? The reason why Capernaum, I think, is such an important part of this conversation is because according to the synoptic tradition in the New Testament, meaning the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, Capernaum was Peter's hometown. This is where he lived, according to those three Gospels, with his extended family. This is where he worked as a fisherman for most of his early life and career. And this is where he first encountered Jesus, as Jesus called him on the shore to be a fisher of men. And this is where he began following Jesus, seeing the miracles of Jesus, etc. So I really believe that understanding Galilee in general and the archaeology of Capernaum in particular can go a long way in helping us to understand who Peter might have been as a historical figure. Now, before I proceed, let's orient ourselves on the map of Galilee. I'll mention a few things about the kinds of excavations that have gone on there, and then we'll spend most of our time tonight looking at Capernaum specifically. You'll notice that here's Capernaum. It's going to be a small fishing village on the northern shore of the Sea of Galilee. And I wanted to point out that in the time of Peter and Jesus, Galilee was undergoing a very interesting period of transition, particularly because when both Jesus and Peter were very young boys, probably, the authority, the political authority over the Galilean region had shifted away from Herod the Great to one of his sons named Herod Antipas. And that son, Herod Antipas, was the tetrarch of Galilee when Jesus and Peter were growing up. And as it turns out, Herod Antipas renovates part of Galilee to update it and Romanize it. And the way he did this was by building two very important cities on the landscape of Galilee. Two cities that were being built and developing while Jesus and Peter themselves were maturing. These two cities are Sepphoris, here on kind of the interior, that's about 4 miles north of the small little hamlet of Nazareth. Right? And the other major city that Herod Antipas will build is the city of Tiberias. A large city is going to be right on the western shore of the Sea of Galilee. These two cities are going to be the Roman strongholds, or at least the Romanized strongholds, in the Galilee. These are going to be very wealthy cities. Herod Antipas is building these cities using Roman construction methods, introducing Roman culture and elite lifestyles into these cities. These cities had all the modern Roman amenities. They had paved streets. They had large monumental public buildings like basilicas and even theaters. They had Roman-style pottery, Roman-style decoration like frescoes and mosaic floors. In short, these cities were becoming Romanized elite cities for Herod Antipas, his administration, and the aristocratic Jewish families that lived in Galilee. However, as you might imagine, the rest of the villages of Galilee were not so. In fact, the rest of the villages of Galilee, including Nazareth and Capernaum, as we'll see in a moment, are not going to be large Romanized cities, but in fact will maintain the characteristics of a traditional Jewish village in the Galilee, as we'll talk about in a second. So before we get to that, let me just mention a few things about this city-village dynamic as it's unfolding in the first century, dynamics that Jesus and Peter will be very much aware of, in fact, they'll be a part of as they're growing up. Well, as it turns out, as archaeological excavations have been conducted throughout Galilee, we're now learning that there was a pretty significant disparity between the two major cities, Tiberias and Sepphoris on the one hand, and villages in the Galilean countryside on the other. It turns out that the ability to build these two Romanized cities came at a great cost to the villagers out in the hinterland. Right? Because, of course, what's needed to build these cities? Well, you need revenue, you need money, you need resources. Where are they going to get these resources and revenues? They're going to get them from taxing the Galilean villagers. So what, in the time of Jesus and Peter, the Galilean political and economic landscape is such that literally the rich are getting richer to build their cities and the poor are getting poorer in a way. So there is an economic strain between city and village in the time of Jesus as the villages are increasingly taxed to support the cities and decrease in their surplus. All those surpluses going to the builders of Tiberias and Sepphoris. As it turns out, some of the other dynamics that exist between city and village in the first century are political and cultural. Just like today, in antiquity, the cities were the center of more progressive thought. Elites, classes who wanted to be more modern, more updated, more with the times, as opposed to the countryside, which tends to be more conservative, more traditionalist. And those political and economic dynamics were very much in play in the first century of Jesus and Peter. As you can imagine, this also had an impact when it comes to Hellenistic culture, meaning Greek-like culture. Because as Sepphoris and Tiberias are Romanizing, guess what's trendy to speak in those cities? Greek. Yeah, the cultural language of the Eastern Mediterranean. As it turns out, though, in the countryside of the villages, they're not speaking Greek. They are, in fact, speaking the traditional Aramaic. So these are some of the dynamics that are shaping the world of Jesus and Peter. And I just wanted to mention some of them to give you a backdrop for understanding Capernaum in particular, the site that, according to the Synoptic tradition, was the hometown of Simon Peter. So let's spend the rest of our time now zooming in on Capernaum itself. Where does Capernaum fall in these political, economic, and cultural dynamics? Well, I want to start by giving a very brief history of Capernaum, and then we'll focus more particularly on the archaeological evidence, so we can see what the archaeology shows us about the village in which Peter grew up. To begin, the name Capernaum literally means the village of Nahum. Okay, that's not the Old Testament prophet Nahum. It's some unknown Nahum. We don't know who this Nahum was. But what we do know is that the village did not exist in the Old Testament period, but in fact was founded probably around the 2nd or 1st century B.C. So about 100 years or maybe 150 years before Jesus and Peter come on the scene, this small village of Capernaum, the village of Nahum, is settled as a small, modest, little fishing village. We do know that by the time of Jesus and Peter, into the 1st century A.D., we do know that Capernaum was, in fact, starting to grow from a very small and significant fishing village to a slightly larger, but still small, and significant fishing village. But here's what we do know about it. We do know that when Herod Antipas becomes the tetrarch over Galilee, over this western half of the region, we do know that all of a sudden, Capernaum finds itself as a border town. You see, these geographical borders that are outlined for you here are the regions of Herod Antipas on the west and Herod Philip on the east. You'll notice that the border goes right in between the two, right, the two regions, and Capernaum is right on that border. So when Jesus and Peter were both young men, Capernaum all of a sudden becomes a border town. And now that it's a border town, you can imagine some of the dynamics that are taking shape there. As the village starts to grow a little bit, Capernaum is going to house tax administrators for tolls going back and forth between the two regions. It's apparent that there's also a road network that's going to be built up that goes right past Capernaum to facilitate travel and trade between the two regions. So Capernaum is going to be getting a little bit more traffic than it had experienced otherwise. And because the village is growing slightly, we can also imagine that some of the less reputable elements of society will naturally find their way there. Some of the beggars and prostitutes that feature so prominently in the Jesus stories start to gravitate towards a border town like Capernaum around the mid-first century when Jesus and Peter begin their ministries there. Very briefly, I'll just mention that after the time of Jesus and Peter, Capernaum continued to exist. In fact, it was starting in the 2nd and 3rd centuries AD, so after the time of the New Testament, that that's when Capernaum itself really began to expand in an impressive way. In fact, just by show of hands, I'm curious, who's all been to Capernaum before? Maybe you've been there in the Holy Land trip. Great, okay, very exciting. So most of what you see at Capernaum today, in fact, comes from the later Roman period expansion of the village in the 2nd and 3rd centuries. Okay? After that, it actually became, in the Byzantine Christian period, a famous site of pilgrimage for Christian pilgrims who wanted to come venerate a building that by that point was considered to be traditionally the House of Peter. The octagonal building that you'll see if you go to the site today was considered, starting in about the 4th century onward, maybe a little earlier, to be the house where Peter actually lived. So a lot of Christian pilgrims are going to visit Capernaum in the Byzantine period. Later on, there's some small Islamic occupation there until the time of the Crusades, after which the village does become abandoned. Until about the 19th and 20th century, when early explorers rediscovered Capernaum and began excavating it, now opening it up to modern research of the type that we are interested in. So let's go ahead and look at some of those excavations. Probably the most substantial excavations that took place at Capernaum after its rediscovery in the late 19th century were excavations carried out between 1968 and 1986 by two Franciscan archaeologists named Stanislao Alfredo and Virgilio Corbo. These were both Franciscan monks who lived at the site, which is owned by the Franciscans, but they also happened to be archaeologists. And so as the Catholic Church was renovating the site for visitors and for tourists in the late 20th century, they asked Alfredo and Corbo to excavate the site, and their excavations are how we know most of what we know about the first century village of Peter. I'll just point out that if you've been to Capernaum, you'll notice some of these key features. You'll notice that dominating the landscape is this large monumental synagogue that Alfredo and Corbo excavated. You'll notice that there is an octagonal building that is the traditional House of Peter. We'll talk about both of those sites more in a few moments. But you'll also notice that Alfredo and Corbo excavated some residential areas as well. Now, as I mentioned, most of what they excavated will date to later periods, so after the time of Jesus and Peter, but their excavations turned up enough information about the first century village that we can make some very interesting observations about the village in which Peter grew up as a young man and as an early disciple of Jesus. So let's go ahead and now take the rest of our time and talk about that first century village based on the archaeological excavations. Let me make some general observations about first century Capernaum first. To begin, Alfredo and Corbo, in their excavations, determined that it seems like in the first century, Capernaum was a modest, unwalled village. Okay, so it had no protective defensive walls. It was unprotected, and it existed in a thin strip right along the shore of the Sea of Galilee. Okay, so it's a modest, unwalled village in a thin strip along the lake. And you know, population estimates are always very squirrely. It's always very difficult to reconstruct population of ancient cities. But some of the best guesses that we've been given are that Capernaum in the first century probably had between 1,000 and 1,500 inhabitants. Pretty small, modest village. It's not quite as small as a little hamlet like Nazareth. Estimates suggest that a little hamlet like Nazareth had only about 300 to 400 people. And it certainly wasn't anywhere near the size of the two big cities, Sepphoris and Tiberias, that could have had up to 12,000 apiece. So at 1,000 to 1,500, Capernaum was a fairly modest, on the lower end, a smaller village. We do know that the major activities of Peter's Capernaum included fishing, right? That's probably obvious since it's on the lake shore. Fishing was obviously a major part of the Capernaum economy. But we also know that agriculture and commerce, especially with Capernaum being located on a trade route, are important parts of Peter's Capernaum as well. And as I mentioned before, Capernaum will definitely be part of these economic dynamics where the smaller villages are being heavily taxed in order to support the building of larger cities. So all of those dynamics will be part of Peter and Jesus' experience in the village. Well, let's talk for a few minutes about civic life in Capernaum. Because when Lofreda and Corbo excavated the village, they found a lot of things related to the first century. Here's what we learned from those excavations. We learned that unlike the larger cities of Tiberias and Sepphoris, we learned that Capernaum has no monumental architecture in the first century. Okay? We do not have basilicas in Capernaum, meaning basilicas like large public administrative buildings. There are no theaters in Capernaum. It turns out that there's also no centralized planning evident in Capernaum. In other words, unlike the cities of Tiberias and Sepphoris, where government officials are laying out the city on a Greek and Roman grid system, Capernaum is not like that at all. Capernaum seems to have developed organically, right? Meaning that as a house would expand, that would naturally create another alleyway. And you can imagine the streets and the alleyways kind of organically developing in the first century BC and the first century AD. So we have no paved streets in Capernaum. We have no paved plazas. All of these streets and alleyways in Capernaum were all packed dirt, okay? Meaning that in the summertime, in the dry season, it'd be very hot and dusty, as you can imagine in this village. And in the rainy season, you can imagine how muddy it would be. Fairly typical for a Galilean village, and that's what Peter's Capernaum seems to have been like. Well, as it turns out, there are also no urban amenities in Peter's Capernaum. Archaeologists found no evidence for drainage systems, aqueducts, sewer facilities, anything like that. Even though in some of the bigger cities, like Sepphoris and Tiberias, those amenities do exist. Okay, there does seem to be evidence for running water in the cities. Some kind of modest sewage system, aqueducts to bring in fresh water. Well, none of that exists at Capernaum. And you can use your imagination to think about what that implies for daily life in Capernaum. There are no public or even private latrines that were excavated at Capernaum, suggesting that just like most villages in the ancient world, inhabitants relieved themselves outside, right, in alleyways and in the streets. The ancient world, especially these villages in which Jesus and Peter operated, was a radically different place than anything that you and I are familiar with. In fact, it's funny, because it's kind of fun, in ancient literature, including early rabbinic literature, we're told that there was a profession of being a manure merchant. There were people, because of this situation, there were people whose job it was to go collect the waste that had accrued in the streets and go sell it for fertilizer. So the sights and smells and sounds of these ancient villages would have been absolutely breathtaking to us. But that was the world in which they operated. Finally, you'll notice that there's little or no Hellenization here. We don't have interior Romanized decor. There's no frescoes. There's no mosaics like we find in the big cities. There's no decoration at all, in fact, leaving the impression that these people are not only fairly conservative, non-Hellenized Jews, but they simply don't have the financial resources to enjoy an upper-class lifestyle like some might in the other cities. And that's the world into which Peter seems to be raised. We'll come back to some of these points here in a few moments. So now that we've talked briefly about civic life in Capernaum, what the excavations have showed us there, let's shift now over to what excavations show us about domestic life at Capernaum. What was it like to live there? We've already had a sense now of what it's like to walk down the streets, breathe in the air of Capernaum. what it was like to live there as a family. Well, as it turns out, several domestic structures were excavated, or at least partially exposed, from the time of Peter in Capernaum. And the pattern in these domestic structures is fairly consistent with other Galilean villages from this period, okay? And here's a rough sketch of what these homes would have looked like. For example, it seems that most of these domestic units, were actually probably three or four small residential buildings clustered around a shared courtyard. Because as it turns out in these villages, extended families all lived together, right? And that's actually the story that we get in the New Testament about Peter. Right? Is that Peter is living in Capernaum with his brother, with his in-laws, and they're all in the same house. Well, that type of arrangement is exactly what's reflected in the domestic architecture at Capernaum. For example, here's an artistic reconstruction of a typical domestic structure at Capernaum. We've got three or four but living rooms around a shared central courtyard where the extended family could share meals and share work activities, etc. Some of these courtyard activities include many of the women's responsibility in a first century village. Grinding the wheat, making the bread, cooking the meals, using shared grinding stones and ovens that are assembled in the courtyard. You'll notice actually that these are not paved courtyards, but they're cobblestones. It's basalt cobblestones intermixed with packed dirt. And that's the world in which these families are operating, including eating their meals, by the way. There are no paved dining halls or dining rooms in these homes. They're sharing meals together on a dirt floor, probably sitting on reed mats. Okay? And so when we're reading stories about Jesus and Peter and sinners and others having meals together in these Galilean villages, that's the scenario that we can imagine. Here are some reconstructions of courtyard implements. These don't actually come from Capernaum. They come from a reconstructed village a little bit north of Capernaum called Katsrin. But nevertheless, they show some of the implements that were there at Capernaum. We've got our wheat grinders. See the grinding stones there? You can imagine the women in the family grinding the wheat. We have ovens for the women to bake the bread and cook some of their stews and soups. And you'll notice the paving. We don't have nice flagstone paving, right? What we have is basalt cobble mixed with packed dirt. I really like enjoy this image because it, in my mind, illustrates the parable of Jesus about the woman who accidentally drops her coin on the floor and she sweeps all day trying to find it, right? Well, now does that kind of make sense? Because the villages in which these people are living and operating, they don't have a nice paved floor where we can easily find our dropped coin. You drop a coin, one of your precious coins that will feed your family for the day or the week, in one of the cracks in between the basalt cobbles or into the back dirt floor, yeah, you can imagine the intensity with which you're going to sweep to find that precious coin. Well, it helps you to illustrate those types of parables. Well, as it turns out, the pottery in Capernaum, in these domestic structures, also tell us a few interesting things about what it would have been like for Jesus and Peter to share meals together. This is an assemblage of most of the common household pottery that's found at Capernaum. You'll notice that we've got cooking pots, right? Round bodies with narrow mouths for producing stews and other simmering meals like beans and so forth. We've got casserole dishes, right? These kind of wide mouth, we'll call them casseroles, they look like a casserole dish, for chopping up meat and vegetables into thin stews, right? And then we've got other jugs and juglets and cups and plates and bowls that help us to envision the typical meal that Peter and his family would have enjoyed. As it turns out, the number of serving dishes are fairly small per household. Very few serving dishes, cups, and plates were discovered in these homes, which means, at least it implies, that the families are sitting on their packed dirt floor, probably on a reed mat, around the same dishes and sharing out of the same casserole dishes. Probably each with their bread dipping into the soups or thin stews. Again, helping us to envision the meal stories of the New Testament Gospels. Okay, well, one or two more things about domestic structures, and then we'll move on to things like fishing and synagogues. Well, a few more observations about the homes include this. We know a lot about how the homes were constructed. We know that the domestic homes in Capernaum at the time of Peter and Jesus were made not with well-cut blocks, like you'll see at the more prosperous cities, but in fact were made with various sized basalt stones that were just kind of cobbled together and plastered together with a mud mortar. Okay? Very crude construction, right? They just simply don't have a lot of resources to do anything else. Because of that style of construction, that means that the homes in Capernaum, the walls do not have the strength to support a second story or a heavy roof. So to put a roof on their houses, what they did was they put wood beams across the building, and they rolled kind of maybe some reeds or some things along those, and then they plastered over the wood and reeds to have a plastered roof. It wasn't the strongest roof, but you could. It was stable enough that you could do some working activities up there. On a cool summer night, you could sleep up there. You could do some food preparation up on the roof, right? And apparently you can access the roof because these courtyards had these crude staircases that would lead you up to that roof. In fact, here are some reconstructions of people kind of reenacting that roof-style construction in a modern Galilean village. You see the basalt, or the fieldstone walls here. You see the wood beams stretching across the room and the reeds that are rolled out over the beams. And then you put the plaster kind of mortar on top, kind of mud mortar on top, and then you roll it with a roof roller, and that's your roof construction. Obviously, anytime it rains, what are you going to have to do? You're going to have to go up there and kind of re-roll the roof, right? Re-plaster it. Well, that's the kind of thing that Peter and his family would have done on a regular basis. This roof-style construction is actually kind of fun because there are New Testament stories that relate directly to it. Do you remember the story of when Jesus was in one of the homes at Capernaum, right? And the crowds were so packed into the courtyard that to get this paralytic man to Jesus, what did they have to do? Remember? Yeah, they had to go through the roof. Well, now you can understand how that story works. To lower the paralytic man down through the roof, they simply had to take him up one of those crude staircases, up on top of the roof, simply had to dig through some mud, plaster, and mortar, dig up a few branches, and you could let the guy down into the room in which Jesus was for the healing. And that's exactly the way Mark describes the event, suggesting that Mark was fairly familiar with a roof construction for a Galilean village. Luke, on the other hand, seems to be not so familiar with that style of roof construction, because when Luke tells that exact same story as a Greek writer who's more familiar with the Greek urban setting, when he hears a story that they broke up the roof to let him down, Luke tells a story that they had to break up the ceramic roof tiles to let him down, right? Suggesting that he actually was less familiar with how a Galilean home actually worked, but he was just kind of imposing a Greek urban style of reconstruction onto this story. So out of these two stories, I think we need to go with Mark because he's the more accurate. Well, you know, time is really getting away from us. Let me just say very quickly that we've already mentioned that starting in the 4th century or maybe a little bit earlier, an early Christian tradition developed that Peter's house was still there, preserved at Capernaum, and a later Byzantine octagonal church was built right on the site. Well, that site has actually been excavated by Wilfreda and Corbo. And what they found is not only the foundations of the Byzantine period church shrine that commemorated the house of Peter, but they also found that underneath were remains of an actual first century courtyard house, just like what we've been describing. Okay? Now, we don't know for sure that this particular house really was the house of Peter. Maybe it was. Maybe it wasn't. All we can say is that later Christians believed that it was. But what we can observe is that the structure that is under the later church is very typical of the types of domestic architecture that we find at Capernaum. So if it's not Peter's house, it's exactly like the house that Peter would have lived in. And here's some reconstructions of here, some observations. Same thing that we just saw. We've got an L-shaped courtyard that was shared by extended family members, right? Which is like we read in the New Testament Gospels. Peter, Andrew, and the in-laws all living together. We have ovens and ash pits, and you can easily imagine, based on this house, the stories of the crowds coming into the courtyard to come see Jesus, or even, as I said, having to break one of the roof stuff to lower the paralytic down. And here is a reconstruction. In fact, the story that, the picture that I've been showing you all night is a very good, very responsible artistic reconstruction of the house that was excavated under the house of Peter. So it probably did look something very, very much like this. Okay, you know, time is really flying here, isn't it? Okay, well, you know, we have a choice to make. We can talk about fishing at Capernaum, or we can talk about synagogues at Capernaum. What do you want to talk about? You want to talk about fishing? You want to talk about fishing? Synagogue, of course, we're fine. Okay, I'll do 5 minutes to each. How's that? Okay, well, as it turns out, so not only did the excavations show us a lot about domestic and civic life at Capernaum, but it also reminds us that Capernaum was primarily a fishing village. The New Testament Gospels tell us that Peter and James and John and Andrew were themselves fishermen when Jesus called them to a life of discipleship. And archaeological excavations around the lake have actually told us a whole bunch. They taught us a lot about how Galilean fishing worked. We know, for example, that the government invested significant resources in building large port towns, like Magdala, where Mary Magdalene was from. Fairly wealthy port town, as it turns out. Tiberias, the large city that Herod builds on the west coast of the lake, significant fishing port there. Well, these larger port towns, these prosperous places like Magdala and Tiberias, have very impressive harbor facilities. They've got moorings to anchor the ships, and they've got paved plazas to unload your wares, unload the fish that you catch in the lake. Capernaum has absolutely none of that. Okay? As far as we can tell, in the first century, Capernaum's fishing harbor facilities were very modest. Probably small jetties kind of sticking out into the lake, just made up of stacked basalt field stones. Not much, just enough to get out into the lake, to get onto your boat, or whatever. This, by the way, is going to be the setting in which Jesus calls the fishermen to be disciples. It's all of our movies about Jesus, you know, walking on this big sandy beach and all this. He's walking down that basalt shoreline, probably walking out onto one of these basalt jetties of stacked field stones, and calling Peter and James and Andrew and John to be fishers of men. There was apparently a very small open area on the shore in the time of Peter where the fishermen could unload their catches. And apparently that's where a tax collector named Matthew had a little booth set up that as the fishermen would unload their catches, Matthew, the tax collector, would be there to count the fish and to tax Peter, James, Andrew, and John, establishing a very interesting relationship that would no doubt flourish in interesting ways in the old serving as well together. Okay, well, unfortunately, we don't have time to really talk about the different styles of fishing. The excavations teach us a lot about the different types of fishing that Peter and James and John would have been participating in. There's large dragnet fishing, there's trammel net fishing with boats, and there's, for the fishermen who have less resources, there's little cast nets, little nets that an individual could just cast into the water and pull in from the shore. As it turns out, the type of fishing that Peter is engaged in seems to be the type of fishing that reflects fewer resources. In the Gospel of Mark, you'll notice that when Peter and Andrew are called by Jesus to be fishers of men, they're fishing from the shore, casting a little cast net. Yeah. But then when Jesus moves down the coast a little bit and sees James and John and their father and the servants, they're in boats with hired hands, suggesting that maybe the James and John family, the sons of Zebedee, might have had a few more resources than Peter and Andrew did. Okay, so that's just a little hint there, depending on which gospel you read. Well, we only have about 5 minutes left. There was an interesting boat discovered. Look it up sometime, it's really cool. Okay, I want to conclude now. We only have 5 minutes left, and I apologize that we were cut short about 10 minutes at the beginning here, but let's go ahead and conclude by now looking at the religious life in first century Capernaum. We now have a sense of what the civic and domestic life was like that Peter would have experienced growing up. We now have at least a sense, cut short, but a sense of some of his fishing activities, maybe even suggesting that Peter didn't have as many resources as some of the other fishermen, perhaps. But now what do we know about religious life in first century Capernaum, that village in which Peter grew up? Well, the excavations, as we'd imagine, in Capernaum turned out to show a very religiously conservative Jewish population. There are no traces of Gentiles in Capernaum. The New Testament Gospels say that there are a few, maybe a few Herodian administrators or something, but the most of the population that's been revealed in the excavations are conservative, traditional Jews. Stone vessel fragments were found in almost every home. And what that implies is that most families in Capernaum, no doubt Peter's included, participated in Jewish ritual purity laws. Because stone vessels, stone cups and stone bowls and stone basins were used to ensure ritual purity as outlined in the book of Leviticus. And the fact that almost every home in Capernaum that was excavated has some of these stone vessels attested suggests that Peter and his family were very at home in a religious, conservative, ritually pure environment. It's also interesting to note an absence of non-kosher animal bones at Capernaum. There are no pig bones that turned up in excavations, or even non-kosher fish bones. There are no catfish bones, for example. What does that imply about the religious life of the village? They're keeping kosher. They're keeping the kosher laws of Leviticus 11. All of these things turn up in the New Testament stories about Peter. And in almost every instance, Peter naturally seems to be inclined to a more religiously conservative position, much more conservative than Jesus appears to have been. For example, when Jesus rebukes the Pharisees in Matthew 15 for insisting that everyone washes their hands with the stone vessels before they eat, it's Peter who afterwards says, "Jesus, you really offended those guys. Kind of uncomfortable. Do you want to explain this to me? Like, what do you mean? We're not really supposed to wash our hands with the stone vessel, right?" Well, suggesting that Peter was part of this society and that Jesus was helping him to kind of break out of that a little bit. Same thing in Acts chapter 10, when Peter gets the vision to bring the gospel to the Gentiles. What's the vision? It's the vision of a bunch of non-kosher foods coming down on a blanket and Peter being told to eat. And what was his natural inclination? His response was, but Peter says, even he says to God, by no means, God, am I going to eat these things? I have never eaten anything that is profane or unclean. In other words, he was very much a product of his culture in Capernaum. Okay, very conservative Jewish culture, suggesting that Peter had to overcome some of his natural cultural inclinations to do what he did as an apostle, bringing the gospel to the Gentiles. We have 1 minute left. I was going to say that we do know from the New Testament Gospels that there is a synagogue in Capernaum. We know that that's where a lot of the healings and miracle stories and teachings of Jesus took place. Peter, no doubt, participated in synagogue worship in his time in the village. Typically, they would have met on holy days, Sabbath, festivals, etc., prayers, Torah reading in Aramaic. These are all things that Peter would have done from the time he was a young man in the village. We do know that there was a synagogue building from the New Testament. However, the short version is, what you see there at the site today is not it. Okay? In fact, the foundations of the site you see today is not it either. Contrary to what many tour guides and some articles will tell you, as it turns out, the synagogue that exists there today, beautiful, monumental limestone synagogue with a huge main hallway and a courtyard and a porch, beautiful as it is, dates to the Byzantine period. Meaning it's long after the time of Jesus and Peter. And even though some scholars early on suggested that maybe the basalt foundations of that limestone synagogue represented the synagogue in the time of Jesus and Peter, for many reasons, that actually cannot be the case. For one, the basalt foundations of the current synagogue would result in a synagogue that's over 50% larger than the largest known synagogue in the first century. I guarantee you that the small fishing village of Capernaum did not have the resources to build the largest synagogue in the region, okay? Number one. Number two, there's simply no evidence for this. No doors, no benches, no building materials, etc. But number three, the most compelling reason, in my opinion, why there cannot have been a synagogue there at this particular site is that in the excavations underneath the synagogue that you see today were the remains of domestic structures from the Hellenistic and Roman period, outlined in red. In other words, in Peter and Jesus' time, the place of the synagogue that you see today when you go to the village was occupied by homes. Okay? So for several reasons, the basalt foundations we see there today simply cannot date to the time of Jesus. We do know the synagogue was there, but what we don't know is how big it was, what its layout was, or where it was. Okay? So let me conclude. I've got minus 1 minute now. So to conclude, in this archaeological survey of Capernaum, what I've tried to show is not only to get a feel for what Capernaum was like, but to try to get a feel for what it was like for Peter to live there. If we're adding archaeology to this search for the historical Peter, what do the remains of his hometown tell us? Well, again, it was a modest fishing village inhabited by religiously conservative Jews. This is in a rural setting. Something that the New Testament Gospels imply, right? How is Peter identified by the Jerusalem elite? By his hick accent, right? Well, he must be from Galilee, listen to him talk, right? What was Peter's reaction when he went down to Jerusalem and saw the monumental building there? He was blown away. Jesus, look at all this. And Jesus had to remind him, well, don't get too excited. This is all gonna go down here in a few years. What about his literacy? Does he know Greek? Well, if he does know Greek, he had to have learned it somewhere else and later in life, because there's simply no evidence for Greek literacy in Capernaum. He might have known enough Greek to conduct business in the area, but probably not enough to write the letters that are attributed to him. Therefore, he had to have either learned it somewhere else later in life, or maybe relied on more educated scribes in the process. But what we also saw in this survey is that Peter fundamentally seems to have been religiously conservative. Part of his conservative Jewish environment growing up, he had to overcome, it seems, some tendencies in his bringing the gospel to Gentiles later in his life. So in short, it seems like the archaeological survey of Capernaum actually supports the more traditional view of Peter as a very modest fisherman with limited means, limited education, that was called nevertheless by Jesus to be the rock on which the Christian church would eventually be built. Thank you very much.